Underneath the city of Geneva, Switzerland, runs a 27-kilometer-long circular tunnel. And in that tunnel is a gigantic particle collider. It allows protons to clash. What is the nature of our universe and what is it made of is what nearly 20,000 scientists, researchers, mostly physicists, ask at CERN, the European Organization for Nuclear Research, or Organisation Européenne pour la Recherche Nucléaire. Now, I mean, the international relations graduate, the European diplomacy innovator, the former journalist between Washington and nearly Vladivostok, the person who works with the universe of people, not physics, was fascinated by three things. First, the celebration of human ambition, of our quest to push these boundaries of knowledge. And second, by this audacity to think big. Now that the science outgrows the existing collider, CERN plans a new one. The future circular collider will be more than 3 times longer than the existing one, cutting through the rocks of the Jura Mountains. And CERN hopes to build and open it by 2045. And the third wow at CERN, that cooperation, that unity of purpose that you need when you study antimatter, when you develop the World Wide Web, you find the Higgs boson, all success stories made at CERN. Now we leave Geneva for a moment and we go on a time travel, 2050. 2050 is when Europe aims to be climate neutral. We have to decarbonize our economies, restore our ecosystems, and we want to do all this in democracies, not autocracy. It's the grandest challenge of our lifetime. Very, very difficult, but at the same time, maybe unleashing fresh innovation, fresh togetherness. This is why the European Commission President calls this climate transition a possible man-to-the-moon moment for Europe. Of course, she refers to the Apollo mission that enabled the actual moon landing in the 1960s. Now, that got my imagination going. And I mean, my three wow buttons were immediately pressed again, just like back in Geneva. And I was thinking, man-to-moon moment, that's amazing. First, it's an ambitious path into uncharted territory, in this case, the universe of people. Second, climate transition means audacity from all of us, the audacity to think big. Because decarbonizing means turning just about everything upside down, right? Norms, standards, lifestyles, values. And once the science outgrows our democratic infrastructure and institutions, let's adjust it, let's triple the effort, let's build a 3 times bigger effort and adjust a more democratic, maybe more network-based system to the needs of our time. And the third wow, yes, we need to cooperate now across sciences and sectors, and more than ever between us, the citizens, and our representatives. But hang on. In 1962, when US President John F. Kennedy launched the Apollo mission, he already had NASA, a grand new civilian research and development organization that made the moon landing possible. Now, if our road to climate neutrality is of the intellectual and practical magnitude of a moon mission, we need a grand new civilian research and development organization to actually make it happen, with the social sciences and applied humanities at the core, a civic CERN. We don't have anything like it. I mean, pioneers in the field tell me they feel like they have to rebuild the kitchen every time they want to cook. Let's think of Geneva again. What is the nature of our universe? And what is it made of, is what we ask at CERN. And we put more than 1 billion euros of taxpayers' money into CERN every year, which is great. What about us putting the same amount of ambition, of audacity, of resources into asking, what is the nature of democratic climate transition? What is that institutional, economic, social, and values transition really made of? How about a civic CERN? I mean, if we want to get climate neutral in only 27 years, we have to know what our mayors need to keep the municipality running and all the services, and at the same time manage a moon mission on the side, i.e. changing the heating and mobility circuits of their inhabitants. We need to know how to train our political and administrative staff in leadership. We need to study civics, the rights and duties of us, the citizens. We need to understand through real-life testing and trying what it takes to sign up the young, the middle-aged, the senior citizens in order to go on that new moon mission. And we need to understand what it takes to push all of us from that knowing to the doing, and not to push us into the arms of the next populist or autocrat. And we need to understand how all this differs between North and South, between this culture and that community. Let us research and develop, let us prototype and scale in a civic CERN. Now, who am I to dream so big? I am not a scientist, I am not a politician, I am not a billionaire. As a European affairs entrepreneur, I have worked that sweet spot between societies and institutions for many years, in a lot of field research, but even more practice. And I like to scout and empower the talents and the topics of tomorrow. And on my travels between peripheries and centers like Brussels, always translating insights and trading ideas, I understood that I'm not alone. There are other explorers and pioneers like me who like to look at the how, not just the what, of the climate transition, and who focus on the many who say yes and not on the few who shout no. Our field is called democracy innovation, and as you can see, there are not really celebrity names in this field yet, or Nobel Prize winners. Because there is no Nobel Prize in democracy innovation. You might have heard of Patricia Nantz, a thought and practice leader in participatory democracy, or of Otto Sharma and the theory U, of Christian Basen of the Transition Collective in Denmark. But let's focus for a moment on Jeanette Gusko in the Orange Bubble. Jeanette listened for many years to a network of 10,000 people who were still born in the Eastern Germany before the fall of the Berlin Wall. She wrote a book, and in it she says, "Transition now needs transition experts on the table in negotiations, in cabinets, and so on." So who are transition experts? And she says, it's people who went through turbulence and change in their lives before. You were born in a different political system. You migrated with or in your family between countries and cultures. Or you grew very rich or very poor from one minute to the next. Then chances are likely that you see a way forward where others don't. And Jeanette, like all the other names I showed you, hints on a hidden superpower of us humans. And it is tacit knowledge. Tacit knowledge is what we gain from living. And in every meeting, every class, every lab we go to, we automatically bring, on the one hand, explicit knowledge, what's written in books, in data clouds, what's outside of us. But we also bring a treasure box of tacit knowledge. It's stored in our minds, souls, and some of it even in our bodies. It's the knowledge that we store from experience and through experience, listening to storytelling grandmothers, going through big moments with family, or mastering the personal and professional moon missions of our own lives. Another innovator is Stephen Boucher. And Stephen put together an anthology of 36 case studies from around the world this year in an academic book. And all these case studies show the magic of explicit and tacit knowledge at play in the world of governance, from a school budget in Czechia all the way to the Constitution of Iceland. The formula of collective intelligence is always the same and everywhere. One and one equals more than two. And it feels great to say this in a technical university, I have to say. It means that together, we always come up with more tangible solutions than when we are asked to solve these problems on our own. So the practices, the pilots, the proofs of concept are here. Many of you know some of these terms like co-creation. That means we work with citizens when working on a new regulation or roadmap in order to make sure they can accept and embrace it from the start. Or think of citizen assemblies. According to the OECD in Paris, nearly 100,000 people have by now taken part in a citizen assembly. That means by random selection or lottery. Just last week, one of these citizen assemblies was taking place again in East Belgium. Now we travel back from East Belgium all the way south, and we come to Geneva again. And we recall that nearly 20,000 people trying to research antimatter might sound a little bit geeky. But hey, CERN gives humanity so much amazing new knowledge in the quantum world. It gives us also hope and joy, pride and dignity. Researching how we, the people, will and can master the road to climate neutrality must not be a matter of geeks. It must be a common matter. So in this time where strong voices dispute the road to climate transition and the urgency of it, in this time when our democratic life and our liberties are at risk like never before. And in this time where actually, as humanity, we have nothing left to lose, why don't we, at least in the rich countries, pool our ambition, our audacity, and our resources to afford a civic CERN? Thank you.